So we're going to open up this session with a word of prayer, and we're just going to trust God for a revelation and a knowledge and understanding of this particular topic in a fresh and a new way. So let's just pray together. Father, we just thank you this evening that, Lord, we can get together and we can study your word once more. And Father, we believe and trust you tonight that even as we study this word and as we go through this word, Lord, that it will ignite our souls and our hearts, Lord, to believe you for more stuff, for more things, and to see this world impacted and changed for Jesus. So we give you all the praise, glory, and honor for what you have accomplished so far and what you're still busy doing, what you're going to do as we study this word and as you reveal it to us in Jesus' name. So, Father, I pray right now that every heart is receptive, every ear is open, every mind is alert to be able to hear the word of God and to be able to receive it and for it to take root and to bring forth much fruit in the life of the hearers. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. I'm excited about the topic tonight. The topic is stewardship. It's something that we've ministered on a lot over the years, and it's something that I feel is very important for us as believers to understand and to know. So let's start out and just get an understanding, a dictionary definition of stewardship. It reads like this. It says conducting, supervising, or managing of something. All right, that is stewarding. Especially the careful and responsible management of something entrusted to one's care. Now, that is the Merriam-Webster dictionary definition of what stewardship is. But if you're going to look at the Word of God and you're going to look at the Bible and look at theory, Charles Buck defines stewardship in the Holman Bible Dictionary as follows. He says, utilizing and managing all resources God provides for the glory of God and the betterment of his creation. I must say, I enjoy the second definition a lot more because it gives you a clearer understanding of what stewardship means from a biblical perspective. It's not just looking after stuff. It is not just going and supervising or managing a situation. It's actually more than that, because with that comes instruction. All right. And with that instruction, you need to follow that through and to be obedient. And normally there's a master-servant relationship, because the things that you are given to steward are normally not yours. You care for stuff that is normally doesn't belong to you. You don't have ownership. All right. And because you don't have ownership, you are stewarding it on behalf of somebody else. So there comes an instruction with it and an obedience to that instruction to see the fulfillment of that which is set out before you. And for me, that's always been a very clear understanding of what stewardship means. And that is what I've applied in my own life. And that is what I've used whenever I have, from my understanding of what God wants us to do with the things that he's put into our care. Now, if you go and study scripture out, you'll find in Genesis chapter 39 is the story about Joseph. And it's sort of like generally accepted that the story of Joseph is one of the brilliant examples in the Word of God of godly stewardship. You know the story about Joseph, how he went through all the different trials and landed up in prison and all that kind of stuff. Then went to Potiphar's house, landed up finding all kinds of challenges. Then ultimately became second in charge in Egypt, and then became the salvation of his family and a lot of people during the drought. So that whole story, if you go and read it, it is sort of like generally accepted that that is a very good example of stewardship and biblical references to it. Now, as I said to you, normally if you're talking about stewardship, especially from a biblical perspective, we understand that the stewardship that God has placed upon us is because of us serving him, all right? And there's a master-servant relationship going on, and the master gives a command, he gives an instruction, and because of that, the servant follows the instruction and he wants to see the fulfillment thereof. So we need to therefore have an understanding that if we're going to approach stewardship from a biblical perspective and from a biblical stance, that there's a couple of things we need to understand. We need to understand that the master that we're dealing with is God himself, and God owns the world. Many scriptures I can give you. Exodus chapter 19 and verse 5 says, now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my commandment, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people. For all the earth is mine. Declaration from God. Earth belongs to him, not to Satan, by the way. All right. Earth belongs to God. Then you've got Haggai chapter 2 verse 8 says, the silver is mine and the gold is mine, says the Lord God of hosts. Job 41:11 says, who has preceded me that I should pay him? Everything under heaven is mine. Then you find in Psalm 50:10-11, it says, "For every beast of the forest is mine, and the cattle on a thousand hills. I know all the birds of the mountains and the wild beasts of the field are mine." So many more scriptures we can go through that emphasizes the fact that God created this stuff, and because He created this stuff, He has ownership because of the creation. It's like if you build something, if you build a house or you build a chair or a table or whatever you build, because you are the creator thereof, you are the owner thereof. It belongs to you, it's yours. And therefore, nobody else can come and claim ownership, especially if you built it, if you've made it. So God makes a statement. He says, "Hey, listen, all these things, I made it, it's mine." And some people think that He's given ownership over to somebody else, or to Satan, or to anybody else. He hasn't. It's still His property, it's still His, belongs to Him. Now, Jesus came to earth as a servant. Mark chapter 10 and verse 45 says, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give His life a ransom for many." So Jesus came with the intent to serve. In other words, He became a servant so that He could serve mankind and at the same time obviously serve God. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 7 says, "But made Himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, coming in the likeness of men." Luke 22:42 says, saying, "Father, if it's your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." Then the same way as Jesus is made Himself a servant and came to this world to serve, we are God's servants as well. We'll find it in 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 1. It says, "Let a man so consider us as servants of Christ and stewards of the mystery of God." There the first time the word steward comes up. In Revelation chapter 7 verse 3 says, saying, "Do not harm the earth, the sea, or the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God and on their foreheads." So we need to understand then that there's a master-servant relationship going on. Even Jesus chose to serve. And because of that, we are subject to whatever the master wants and requires from us. And therefore, we have the responsibility to steward well and to steward the way He wants us to steward. So let's have a look then at a couple of things that relate to this whole issue of stewardship. The first thing is, what is required for being or becoming a good steward? What is required? What is needed? The first thing is faithfulness. We need to consider faithfulness in our lives. Luke chapter 16 and verse 1 says this. He also said to His disciples, "There was a certain rich man who had a steward, and an accusation was brought to him that this man was wasting his goods." All right? In 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 1 through 2, it says, "Let a man so consider us as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that one be found faithful." 1 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 1, sorry, chapter 1 verse 2. So the first thing we look for in a steward is faithfulness. Faithfulness from the servant to the master. Faithfulness from the steward to the master. All right, that you're not going to come back and jab him in the back or betray him or do something like that, but faithfulness. Then the second issue we look for, the second requirement for a good servant is integrity. You know, something that we're looking for in the men and women of God. Titus 1 verse 7 says, "For a bishop must be blameless as a steward of God, not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not given to wine, not violent, not greedy for money." All right, so therefore you've got to have integrity in your life. Matthew chapter 5 verse 16 says, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." Another scripture that lines up with that one is John chapter 15 verse 8, I think it is, which says, "My Father is glorified by us bearing forth much fruit." So there is a need, an inherent need, that if we want to be a disciple of Christ, that we honor Him and that we bear forth much fruit and we do good works. Luke chapter 2 and verse 52 says, "And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men." Same thing with you and I. As we grow and we increase in wisdom and stature, we will also find the unmerited, undeserved, unearned favor that comes upon us because of our Father and because of who He is. So therefore, we need integrity. Faithfulness, integrity, if you want to be a good steward. The third one is you need wisdom. Luke chapter 12 and verse 42 says, "And the Lord said, who then is that faithful and wise servant whom his master will make ruler over his household to give him their portion of food in due season?" So there we see a third requirement. So from a, if you and I want to be good stewards, we need to be faithful to our master. We need to be, we have to have integrity in our lives, and we need to operate in wisdom. If you don't have wisdom, the Bible says, ask for it, Book of James, and you'll receive wisdom. What are we good stewards of? What do we steward, in other words? What are the things that you and I need to steward over? Now, the first thing you've already seen in some of those scriptures is the mysteries of God. That is the first thing. One of the first things you and I need to steward is the mysteries of God. As you and I become, come into the kingdom of God, things that of God will start being revealed to you and I. And those truths are treasures. It's things that you and I use to improve and to grow us and to mature us and to bring us to a place in Christ where we can be the effective witness that He wants us to be. And therefore, the first thing that you and I need to be able to steward effectively is the mysteries of God. The next thing we need to be able to steward is everything that God has given us. All right. So we now talk about tangible stuff. Things that are around about us. We have the responsibility to steward this world, our environment, our everything, our assets, everything that God's given us, everything that has come to us, we need to steward. We need to look after that, and we need to manage it well. Then our families. We need to steward our families well. Excuse me. It is a responsibility in our lives that we need to steward that offspring that God gives us, our children. We need to steward our family well. Males and females, doesn't matter. Husband, wife, doesn't matter. We have to steward our families well. We have to honor God and do what God wants us to do. Next thing we have to do is we have to steward the family of God, which is the body of Christ, which is the church. Because God has given the fivefold ministers a responsibility to be the voice of God into those people and to edify and to grow the saints. You'll find that in the book of Ephesians chapter 4. In Titus chapter 1 and verse 7 it says, for a bishop must be blameless as a steward of God, not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not given to wine, not violent, not greedy, or not greedy for money. We need to steward our gift, that which God has given unto us, that which He's entrusted us with, that ability and that skill that He's placed in you and you use as a gift to help people and to also further the kingdom of God. We need to steward that well. 1 Peter chapter 4 verse 10 says, as each one has received a gift, minister it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. So we use that gift for the benefit of others. You know, we bear fruit so that others might feast off the fruit that our lives bear. So we need to make sure that we steward the gift that God has placed within us, that which He's entrusted us with. We need to steward it well so we can further and grow His kingdom. We need to steward our finances well. It means that you need to put the time and the effort and the energy into learn what God teaches, or what the Word of God teaches rather, about finances and how we're supposed to handle our finances here on earth. To be generous in what we do, to give, to bless others, to help others, to see people that have got a need, the needs met. We have to trust God that when we sow and we give seed and we bless people and we do all the things that the Word instructs us to do, that God will honor His Word and He'll multiply and increase that back to us so that we steward the money that He's given us already. I believe that God gives us wisdom to take the money that He's entrusted and given to us and grow it and even develop it and allow it to bless us and other people around about us. So we need to be good stewards in the things, or in the finance, in the tangible stuff that God has given us. So we have then got responsibilities, that the things that we need to steward is basically everything round about us as a good master and as God has taught us. Now, I believe that the next point is most probably the most critical one out of everything we've covered so far. Because whenever I've taught on stewardship, whenever I spoke about stewardship, this to me is the key. This is what makes us the stewards that God wants us to be. Here is the word. It's obey instructions. In Acts chapter 5 and verse 29, it says, but Peter and the other apostles answered him and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. Okay, so we understand that truth. Acts chapter 5 verse 32 says, and we are His witnesses to these things, and so also is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey Him. And having been, sorry, that's in Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 9 says, and having been perfected, He became the author and the eternal salvation of all who obey Him. James chapter 1 verse 20 says, but be ye doers of the word and not hearers only. All right. Deceiving yourselves. Now, remember that in Luke chapter 19, there's the whole parable of the steward. Remember the giving of the talents, 10, 5, 2, or 1. And then the one that 10 went out and multiplied them. Second one went out and multiplied. Third one took his and buried it in the ground. All right. And then when the master came back and brought them to a place of accountability, which we'll cover just now. When the master came back, what did he hold them responsible to? Because he told them, if you look at the parable, he gave them instruction. He said, listen, the talents, you take them and you go and trade. Okay. So he gave them an instruction what to do. Two of them did that. The third one didn't. Okay. The third one was disobedient to the instruction of the master. The first two weren't. The first two saw success. The third one didn't. Now, I don't personally believe that the measure of success was all that critical in this whole story. I think that was just shared with us for information. What I do believe with all my heart about this particular parable is the fact of obedience. Because the two that were obedient to the master and did what they were instructed to do, they saw success, yes. But they were praised for their obedience and they were rewarded for their obedience doing what the master says. Because when he got to the third one got really taken to task about the fact that he was disobedient and that he did not do what the master told him to do. So I believe that even though he was concerned that he might lose the talents that the master had entrusted him with, that was not what the master was really concerned about. What the master was concerned about was whether obedience. So even if he did lose the money, he would have done it because he was obedient to the master. And because he was obedient to the master, he also would have achieved success, even though he lost the money. That's what I believe. So I believe that that whole parable talks about the obedience issue and the obedience to the instruction of the father. And you and I have to get it to a place. If we want to be the stewards that God wants us to be, we have to develop a sensitivity to the voice of God, and that you and I obey the instructions that He gives us on a daily basis. All right. If your ears are sensitive to the small, still voice of the Holy Spirit, He is talking to you every single moment of every single day. All right. And when He does talk to you, He gives you instructions of things to do to get out of the circumstance that you find yourself in or the situation you find yourself in. I hear many people talk about them not being able to get deliverance from challenges that they are facing. They're trusting God for rent. They're trusting God for this, for that, for the next thing. And when they believe in God, they don't see the miracle happening. They don't see the word of God being honored in their lives the way that they expect it to. But I do believe that if you look at scripture again, you go through the gospels, you will find that most of the miracles, I'm not saying every single one of them, but most of them, there was an instruction attached to that miracle. Go and wash your eyes in the river. Pour water, to change the water into wine, go and fill the vats. If you want, you know, deliverance from the lack, the woman with the oil, they had to go and pour the oil in the pots until the pots ran out. All these miracles, Old and New Testament, if you look at them, most of them required an action from the hearer. All right. And if you went and did what you were instructed to do, very often the miracle would manifest and the person will receive that which they wanted through obedience. Okay. And I believe that today that has not changed. I believe most miracles in our lives, God will instruct you to do something. Maybe sow a seed. Maybe going and being in a certain place at a certain time. Phone somebody. Talk to somebody. Etc. etc. Many, many different things. If you and I can just learn to hear the voice of God and we can be obedient to the instruction that He has given us, we will start seeing the manifestation of the results of the Word of God in our lives in a more affluent way than you would ever have dreamt possible. The problem is that we do not always recognize the voice of God and we're not obedient to the instruction that is given to us. Here in the story of the talents and of this good steward, you will find that the three of them had to deal with this issue of obedience. The issue of instruction to them. And those that were followed the line and did what was, they were told to do, saw success and at the same time received the praise and at the same time had the master on their side and heard the words, well done, good and faithful servant. So you and I need to understand and learn that in today's, if we want, sorry, if we want to be the stewards that God wants us to be, this to me is like one of the most critical keys involved in the whole story about stewardship. It's not for us to decide what to do with the asset once the asset has been entrusted to us to look after it. You see, if you go back to the beginning and you listen to that definition that was given, the definition basically says, the dictionary definition says, conducting, supervising, and managing of something, all right? The Bible definition that, Charles Bug put out in the Holman Bible Dictionary says, utilizing and managing all resources God provides for the glory of God and the betterment of His creation. I wish he would have just added to that with obedience to His instruction, to God's instruction with those assets. Because I believe that that is the key. I believe the key is that we will be given assets and we'll be given things and resources and whatever to steward and to look after and to care for. Now, stewardship, I just want to bring this out there as well. Stewardship is not caretaking. All right? You're not a caretaker of the stuff. Because if you were a caretaker, then that third person that got chowed out because he didn't do what he was told to do, that would have been very unfair. Because he was a good caretaker. He actually took the coin, put it in the ground, made sure it was safe, looked after it. He was a brilliant caretaker. All right? He took care of that coin. That coin was not going anywhere. It was not going to be destroyed, stolen, whatever. He was a brilliant caretaker. But the master was not looking for a caretaker. He was looking for a steward. All right. So we are not caretakers. God is not putting gifts and things into our hands for us to be caretakers of it. That's not the intention. With stewardship, you and I have a call to action. We are called to follow and to be obedient to the instruction that the master has given so that we can see the fruit of whatever he requires on that particular thing. He and God will speak the blessing. God will speak the increase on those things. And so therefore, we don't want to necessarily just be caretakers. We want to be stewards. There's a difference between the two. And we need to understand therefore that as we go into these things for God and we look at the things that God has entrusted to us, and we look at what God, the gifting God has given us, and we look at all the things that are around about us. To hear those words, well done, good and faithful servant, I believe you and I need to be obedient to His instruction. It is more important for you and I to find out what the instruction is and what God wants us to do with the things that He's entrusted to us, rather than just being a caretaker and putting the stuff and making sure it's safe, making sure that it's not going to get hurt, make sure it's not going to get destroyed, etc., etc. That's not what stewardship is about. Stewardship is not about caretaking. So I wanted just to emphasize that because I've seen many people that confuse the concept of caretaking with the concept of stewardship. And that is not what it's about yet. So we therefore have the responsibility to therefore steward what God's given us, the mysteries of God. We are there to steward everything material that holistically that is entrusted to us, our families, the church, God's family, the gifting that He's placed in us, and our financial resources. Okay? So, from that then, what does the steward get? Sorry, when does the steward get their reward? Stewards get our reward after the works have been judged according to their obedience. In Luke chapter 19 and verse 15, it says, "And so it was that when he returned, the master, having received the kingdom, he then commanded these servants to whom he had given the money to be called to him, that he might know how much every man had gained by trading." So we need to understand, therefore, that your reward for doing whatever stewarding you're going to do is all dependent on obedience to God's word. Now, I believe that some of the rewards will come quick. Some of the rewards will take time. And I believe some rewards we might not see until we get to heaven one day. Because it all depends on what the obedience and the instruction was and what the stewardship is. Very often, if it's stewarding assets, we might multiply and increase the assets here on earth because we're obedient to God's word. He might say, buy this property, then sell it, and you make a big profit, whatever. So that's just an example of how you and I can possibly see a quick reward on some of the instructions that were given unto us. So I do believe that there's going to be certain things where we're going to see a quick reward, but then there are other things that you might not see until you leave this earth. And the obedience in that might be to do with God's, the body of Christ. It could be to do with who knows what. And the thing is, that will only manifest after time. So in 2 John verse 1 through 8, it says, look to yourself that we do not lose those things which we worked for, but that we may receive a full reward. Okay, I believe that we need to trust God for that. I believe that we need to believe God that we're not going to fall short in any way, that the things that that God has promised, God will fulfill. In Luke chapter 6 and verse 22 to 23, it says, blessed are you when men hate you, and when they exclude you and revile you and cast out your name as evil for the sons of man's sake. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for indeed your reward is great in heaven. For in like manner their fathers did to the prophets. Okay, as I said, some rewards you're not going to see until you get to heaven. Luke chapter 6 verse 35 says, but love your enemies, do good and lend, hoping for nothing in return, and your reward will be great, and you'll be sons of the Most High, for he is kind to the unthankful and evil. Okay, 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 8 says this. It says, now he who plants and he who waters are one, and each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor. Now, you saw that in the story of the parable of the sower. Or the good steward rather, you saw the parable where the guy that got 10 talents, he multiplied, got 10 more, and he was given authority over many cities. Whereas the guy with lesser talents, 5, he also multiplied, he also doubled. But at the end of the day, he didn't get the size of the reward the first one got. So each one will get their own rewards. And I believe those rewards will be fair rewards, and they'll be just rewards, and they'll be right rewards. Okay? And then it carries on to 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 14. If anyone's work which he has built on, it endures, he will receive a reward. There's many rewards that we're going to get in heaven over and above what we receive here on earth anyway. 1 Corinthians 9 verse 17 says, for if I do this willingly, I have a reward, but if against my will, I have been entrusted with a stewardship. Revelation 11 verse 18 says, the nations were angry, and your wrath has come, and the time of the dead, that they should be judged, and that you should not and that you should reward your servants, the prophets and the saints, and those who fear your name shall name small and great, and should destroy those who destroy the earth. Revelation 22 and verse 12, and behold, I'm coming quickly, and my reward is with me to give to everyone according to his work. So there are things that God has commanded us and given us to do that we will not see the reward here on earth, but we'll see the reward when we get to heaven one day. And there will be many rewards because it will come before us and we will receive the rewards for the instructions and the things that we were supposed to do. But then there are other things that if you are obedient here on earth, you'll see the reward here on earth because it'll have to be tied to works that you are busy doing with here, and you'll see the increase and multiplication and the reward that comes from that. So I want you to look at this particular parable then, or this topic rather, of stewardship. And I want you to understand that it's not a light topic. It is a topic that you and I need to understand what stewardship means. It's important and critical that when we are stewarding something, that we understand what God says about that. We need to understand also that once we accept Christ into our lives, our mindset changes in that everything we have actually belongs to God at the end of the day. And therefore, we don't actually own anything. We are only the stewards thereof. And because we're the stewards thereof, we have a responsibility towards God to do the things that we need to do with the things that He's entrusted to us to achieve that which He wants to accomplish. It's His will be done, not mine. It's His purpose that's being fulfilled, not mine. And it's His kingdom that we need to build and grow, not mine. So therefore, I have a totally different mindset in the things of the Lord. So when it comes to stewardship, I have a sober mind. I think about it very clearly. I understand and I do not take possession of it that I can say it is mine. I have to look after it. Even a simple thing like your motor car. How well are you stewarding your motor car? Do you keep it clean? Do you look after it? Do you maintain it? Etc., etc. Do you do these things? Because as a good steward, that's what you should be doing. When people look at what you have, they need to be able to see, okay, this man or this woman is looking after the stuff that they've been entrusted with. That's just a simple example. But we have to have a mind after the things of the Lord, after the things that He's purposed and planned, because we have to see the fulfillment of His will in our lives. So therefore, everything that He's entrusted us with, we are stewards thereof. So we need to therefore listen to the Master's instruction. Find out what God wants you to do with the stuff that He's entrusted you with. And as you start learning what He wants you to do and what the responsibilities are that you have of those things, you will start seeing God entrusting you with more and more and more, and the increase will come and the multiplication will come, and God will trust you with more to be able to do more, to accomplish more for His kingdom at the end of the day, and to see the kingdom grown, to see the kingdom established here on earth. So if you have any questions tonight, I want you to go to the Instagram group and just put it out there. And let's see what we have here, if anything has come through yet. And then we can basically answer those questions quickly. All right. Okay, so okay, Pastor Les, in short, what is the difference between stewardship and discipleship? Okay, discipleship is when you disciple people to do in the things of the Lord. Okay, so in other words, you're teaching them, you're growing them, you're developing them, and they're doing the things that God wants them to do. All right, so that is the discipleship. So discipleship is I train, I encourage, I mentor, I coach, I exhort, all those things. I disciple. And the whole idea is to become more like Christ at the end of the day. All right. So stewardship is when God entrusts something to you that is in your hands and that you have to now, it could be there for your blessing. It could be there for your provision. It could be there for you to use to build the kingdom of God. It could be whatever the instruction is that God gives you for that particular thing. Like say for argument's sake, if you're trusting God to build a clinic or build a hospital or build a rehab center or whatever, say that's your passion and that's your desire, that's what you want to do. You're going to need some money to do that. You're going to need some contacts and whatever. And God will entrust finances to you, but the finances won't be for you. The finances will be for you to be able to accomplish what you are trusting God to do, build a rehab or build a clinic or build a hospital. So therefore, you have to understand that that is seed most probably. So if it's seed, then possibly God expects you to grow that seed by blessing and sowing that seed and multiplying it, increasing it, building, releasing your faith, trusting God, so that you can get up to that level where you'll have enough funds to be able to do what God has called you to do. So the instruction, the obedience would be, I'm giving you seed, sow the seed. All right? Where some people will receive the seed and then eat the seed and not have seed to sow, and therefore the money won't grow to be able to accomplish what God has called it to do, because they didn't listen to what God was saying and the instruction He was given them to do. There's many different things that God will entrust you that you need to steward, you need to look after, you need to take care of, and you need to follow the instruction that the Master has given you, which is completely different to discipleship. Discipleship has got to do with people. It's got to do with growing people, looking after people, shepherding people, pastoring people, coaching them, teaching them, whatever is necessary to grow them into mature believers at the end of the day. All right, so that's what discipleship is about versus stewardship. Stewardship is more looking after things. right? Caring and looking after things and doing with those things whatever you God instructs you to do. All right. Hopefully that clears the two or differentiates the two for you. Okay. Looking further down. Okay. There's nothing else there. And then, yeah, that's about it. So I think let's close this one down and bring it to an end. And then you guys can have a 10-minute break or so. And then Pastor Connie will be on to handle the last topic tonight. So let's just close in prayer. Father, we just thank you tonight. That Lord, even as this word on stewardship has gone forth, Father, I believe tonight that it's fallen on fertile ground. I believe and trust that that people would receive it, Father God, and be able to grow and to mature in the things of the Lord. Father, I pray that the word will not return void, but it will accomplish what has been purposed and planned and sent out to do, Lord, in Jesus' name. So, Father, now I just pray for your covering, your protection on everybody, Lord, as they go and they just take a break before the next session in Jesus' name. Amen. May the Lord bless you. Hang around. Pastor Connie will be back soon.